Shakyamuni Buddhaya, con kính bạch sư ông và kính thưa đại chúng. Namo Shakyamuni the Buddha. So dear respected Thai, dear Sangha and dear friends. Today is the 30th of October and we are in the full moon meditation hall of the new hamlet during our fall retreat. Our fall retreat will soon come to an end. There are just two more days of mindfulness left, and then we will begin our three-month winter retreat starting on the 15th of November. And the winter retreat is for the monastics, the rains retreat, which the Buddha established for all monastics to observe once a year in their life, to deepen their practice, to practice mindfulness, concentration, and insight during 3 months of staying in the practice center and not leaving. This morning we chanted the three jewels of the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. And we know that every morning when we chant in English, we chant that the Dharma is deep and beautiful. We now have a chance to see it, to study it, and to practice it. And we vow to realize its true meaning. So we think that the Dharma is very precious. We understand that the Dharma is the teachings that the Buddha has given, the teachings that our spiritual ancestors have passed on to us, and the teachings the Thai has also transmitted to us. These teachings are as deep as the ocean. And sometimes we feel we cannot understand them fully enough. But this is our life, this is our practice, to understand as best as we can where we are. What are these teachings? How can we apply them in our daily life? The Dharma brings us the capacity of healing. It brings us joy and happiness and transformation of our suffering. The Dharma is also as beautiful as each country in which it is practiced. So we don't think we can define the Dharma. It's to be experienced and practiced for ourselves, both in Asian countries and in the Western countries now. We now have a chance to see it. What does it mean to see the Dharma? Thay has always said that the Dharma is a living Dharma. It's our practice. So we can see the practice. When we come to a day of mindfulness, we're surrounded by everyone practicing mindfulness. And that is very supportive. So the Dharma is not limited to the recording teachings. It's alive. The Dharma is our mindful breathing, our mindful walking, our sitting with peace, our mindful eating, tasting the food, appreciating Mother Earth who has offered the food to us. The Dharma is, of course, the recorded teachings that the Buddha offered. And it is said that Ananda memorized all the teachings, and thanks to the Buddha's attendant Ananda, we have a record of the Buddha's teachings. For me, the Dharma is also the beautiful autumn leaves. I don't know if we can see the leaves very clearly now because there's some fog. For me, the trees teach the Dharma. They teach of impermanence. The leaves are changing, and they speak of impermanence. In fall, we see the beautiful colors, and we notice the leaves are falling. So that's impermanence, the teaching of impermanence. For me, that's the Dharma. In the spring, the leaves of the tree teach of impermanence, but in another way. That's the re-manifestation of life. The little buds, the tiny green leaves, are saying life continues. So the trees can teach the Dharma of no birth and no death, but just that life will continue. There is the manifestation of tiny green leaves, the duration of the leaves, the trees offering their fruit, and then in the fall we see the cessation of the leaves. They go to the ground, they become one with the earth. So that's the cessation of manifestation. We don't say that the leaves are born and they die, but we can consider that they manifest, and then there's a time for their ceasing to manifest. And they go back to the source of the earth, and then they'll re-manifest again. The trees also express the generosity of the Dharma. The Dharma is there for everyone. We don't have to be Buddhist to appreciate and understand the Dharma. Mindfulness is now practiced almost everywhere by people of Christian background, Hindu background, Jewish background, Muslim background, or no particular spiritual path. So mindfulness is part of the Dharma, and it's generous, it's available, always giving to anyone, anytime. The trees as messengers of the Dharma are also very generous because they offer the fruit and they also offer us oxygen. And they live the life of no self, because the trees realize for them to continue to grow and to offer their function of offering oxygen and fruit, the trees rely on the earth, Mother Earth, the minerals, the soils that nourish the roots of the trees. The trees rely on the sunshine, the fresh air, and the rain. So we have in just one manifestation of the tree, the teachings of the Dharma. So we want to protect our sacred inheritance of trees and Mother Earth with our love and appreciation of their presence in our life. We chant that we now have an opportunity to see it, study it, and practice it. So the studying of the Dharma is up to each one of us, whether we want to actually read the Buddhist, the sutras, or
watch the DVDs on YouTube of Thay's teachings. By practicing the Dharma is something we can do when we come together on a day of mindfulness such as today. We have a chance to enjoy walking meditation, eating mindfully, and then in the afternoon there'll be some discussions where we can share our experiences in discussion groups of according to languages. And the final sentence is, how can we realize the true meaning of the Dharma? We make a vow, we want to realize the true meaning of the Dharma. We don't have to wait too long. Any moment of understanding is realizing the meaning of the Dharma. And we can look at our understanding of the Dharma or of any spiritual tradition as a lifelong growth into greater understanding and wisdom and compassion. So we don't have to expect to realize it all at once right now. We can give ourselves the compassion and time that we need to understand more fully what does it mean to practice, what does it mean to have these values, the values, for example, of the 5 mindfulness trainings or 14 mindfulness trainings, which are offered as a global ethic, the values that we can cherish and practice to prevent suffering and to also transform the suffering. So the Buddha said, in this sense, the Dharma is outside of time. We don't have to say, I will realize the true meaning of the Dharma by next week or next year. It's not that. It's just being fully present in the here and now and being able to calm our mind so that whatever understanding is ready to manifest, it will manifest. And it just manifests like that, outside of the time of the past or the future. But we know Thay has very often encouraged us to live in the present moment. And this is what the Buddha also taught. Durista dharma sukha vihara. It's enough to simply dwell happily in the present moment. So this present moment is something very precious. If we know how to live in the present moment, then we can have more peace and freedom. We won't be pulled away to the past with our memories. Whatever might have brought us suffering in the past, we don't spend too much time there. We don't jump ahead too much into the future either, hoping that something will happen to bring us happiness. Often we think that if these conditions can be met, then I will be happy. It's the if, then happiness is possible. But truly happiness is possible in the here and the now. Another aspect of time is to consider, all right, so we have past, we have future, and we have the now. But maybe we want to ask ourselves, how do we actually use our time? How do we use the now? And Thay has suggested that we look into how we use our time.
just as a way of measuring where do we give our energy and our attention. For us living here, for our lay friends who are residents, and for the monastics, Thay suggested that we look into how much time are we practicing. Do we come to the sitting meditation? Do we attend the scheduled practice times? Or do we skip? If we skip, what do we do instead of practicing? We should ask ourselves that. So we want to know how much time do we use in the scheduled practice time, sitting meditation, walking meditation. If we don't do walking meditation, we want to ask why. And what do I do instead of walking meditation? How am I using my time? So we have time set aside for practice, time for study. For many of us here, we study the classes that are we take, the courses that are offered in our precepts, but also language study. I think all of us are studying either Vietnamese, French, or English. So others may be also studying Chinese and other languages to be able to share the teachings in different countries. Practice, study, work. I think we all know there are working periods here. And is a working period a time for practicing? This is what we want to ask. Am I practicing during work? Am I in touch with my breathing? Is my body relaxed? Am I doing the work to get it done? Am I attentive to every detail? Is it expressing my mindfulness and awareness? And then the final aspect of how we use our time is for playing together or relaxing or resting. So we have different lifestyles. If you have children, you can play with your children. And here we enjoy drinking tea together and relaxing. We offer relaxation for our guests who come, another aspect of how we use our time. So you can think of what percentage of my time is given to each of these activities. Sometimes we don't think we have enough time, and this is a wrong perception. Of course, there may be many things that we have to do, but we can always make time. We can make time to stop and to breathe. That we can do, and it doesn't take too long. So I propose we do that right now, so we can experience, I can make time to stop and breathe. And with this breath, I'm going to enjoy relaxing, particularly on the out-breath. So let's listen to the sound of the bell, and then sit comfortably. We're making time for ourselves. And this is precious and important to know. It's possible. And it will be only for a few seconds, but it will give us the benefits beyond measure. So let's enjoy our breathing now. Friends, when we give ourselves this gift of making time for ourselves, And we know that peace is possible, and we have more energy to continue with the many things that we have to do, many things that are awaiting us, the many people that are counting on us. So the gift of making time to just stop and breathe is a very precious gift. Last night, I think almost everybody knows, we turned the clocks back. So we did something with time, didn't we? I learned yesterday evening that now, because of the use of the cell phone, many cell phones are actually doing that for you. We don't have so many watches on people's wrists. You don't do anything to turn the clock back or forward. You look at your cell phone or your electronic device, and then we know what time it is. So maybe everybody didn't turn their watch back, but we were aware that we had one more hour. And we heard, oh, one more hour of sleep. How wonderful. We didn't hear, oh, one more hour to sweep the floor or one more hour to cook. We heard, one more hour to sleep. And I wanted to find the history of who started this. Whose bright idea was this to turn the clock back? And it's quite an interesting history. It was first proposed by an Englishman, William Willett. And it was particularly in respect to creating a summertime, more light in the evening, and also to save energy. But his idea was not accepted by the parliament, so nothing happened. However, Germany was the first country to actually enact the changing of the clock, and this was in 1915, they adopted it. And it was immediately taken up and followed by UK, by England. And this was in their effort to save fuel for the war that was going on in 1915, 1916. So they did this to save energy. And shortly after that, in 1915, France adopted the daylight saving time, called daylight saving or summer time. Well, what we did last night was to end the summer time. We ended the daylight saving time and we have started winter time or standard time. And what this does, it gives us more light in the morning. Okay, so we have more light now. The sun will rise 1 hour earlier. And that's nice if we like to do exercise or look at the trees or enjoy the fresh morning air. It'll be lighter now for us in the morning. When we speak of energy, we know sunlight is a source of energy, and electricity is a source of energy, and they were wanting to change time by being able to save electricity. But all of us are practitioners, and we know that our mindfulness is also an energy for us. If we've been practicing just a few days, we may notice that simply by stopping and breathing, my mind is less dispersed, so I'm not losing my energy. And during the moments of mindful breathing, I'm not talking. And that's also a way to save our energy. If we've been practicing a little bit longer, for a year,
2 years, 5 years or longer,
we have more of an experience of mindful practice. Mindfulness practice is a way of concentrating our energy. So for us, we concentrate our energy with the practices, the Buddhaghaya of mindful breathing. We're aware of our breathing. We follow our breath from the beginning to the end. And this is the beginning of developing our concentration on one object. And then we become aware of our body. And with our breathing, we can relax our body. And when we're able to relax, then our energy is centered. We're not dissipating and losing our energy. So mindfulness is truly a source of energy for us, developing our energy more and more. When we look at our teacher Thay's 70 years of mindfulness practice, we know that he has inestimable energy. He traveled the world, he offered so many retreats, he taught here, and even now during his period of recovering from a serious stroke, he has the energy of practice to continue to do that. So mindfulness is a source of energy for us, and it's a developing source of energy. It will continue to offer more and more stability, peace, and freedom to us as we continue our life of practice. So let us create some more peace and energy in us right now with a second opportunity. While breathing, we're just aware of our breath. We'll let go of our thinking. We won't try to make the breath be anything other than our normal breathing. And then we can experience, after our breathing, some more energy available. I asked our bell master to put the clock there because I cannot see the clock because of the camera. And I know there is awareness of time for me, and to give all of us a chance to enjoy the walking meditation today. So now we'll appreciate giving ourselves a little more energy of mindful breathing. That comes from our mindful breathing. Dear friends, after breathing, do we feel a little more stable, solid within ourselves? We experience our capacity to come back to ourself, to experience the peace that is there, to experience more stability, to experience more freedom from
our thinking of the past and the future. We know very well the Buddha said, do not pursue the past. Do not lose yourself in the future. The past no longer is, and the future has not yet come. But looking deeply at life as it is, in the very here and now, the practitioner dwells in stability and freedom. And then he added, we must be diligent today. So the aspect of diligence encourages us just to continue. When we practice stopping and looking deeply, we can see the sources of happiness that are available to us. We still have health that is good enough to enable us to come here. We still have our friends, we have our sangha. We have a roof over our head. The sisters are now cooking for us. We will enjoy a beautiful meal together in the meditation hall this afternoon. We have so many sources of happiness that are available for us in the here and now. And this is the looking deeply to really discover, wow, life is truly beautiful. If I bring myself back to the present moment, if I open my eyes, if I open my ears to hear the beautiful birds, to see the beautiful autumn leaves, to smell the fresh air, to taste the wonderful food that is offered and prepared. These are sources of happiness. And when we look deeply, we can recognize them. Then we're not caught in the past with our worries. We're not trapped in the past with our suffering. It's just this aspect of the past with all its suffering that prevents us from feeling free and happy in the present moment. So as practitioners, we can ask ourselves, where does my suffering come from, really? Do I have to suffer? Do I have to continue to suffer? Is it necessary? But sometimes we have the habit energies of staying in the past too long. We heard a wonderful Dharma talk last Sunday in French from Sister Downyam on habit energies and understanding them and learning how to transform them. But if we're suffering because of our thinking about the past, it's as if we're in a dark room and we can't find the way to come out of this dark room. And so Thay has recommended that please let us stop looking at that film that we repeat over and over again, where we look at our suffering without ending. We keep showing that same film in our mind. But we can stop it, and the way to stop it is to remember the word stop. Stop it. How? Breathe. We'll come back to ourselves in the present moment, which we've done already together, collectively, already twice, and it's been very easy. So we'll bring ourselves back to the present moment. Stop. Breathe. Relax. And then look around. Then look around. We see we have friends in the practice here. We have the beautiful autumn leaves right now. We are supported by the Sangha, by our friends, supported by so many elements in the here and now. So we change the film, we change the CD. And this is one way to come out of the dark room of suffering, come out of the past, come to the present moment. Sometimes our suffering has been transmitted from our ancestors. We may have known some of them, our parents or grandparents, but our ancestors go back many, many generations, so we may not have actually known exactly what suffering has been transmitted. We've received suffering from our growing up years in school, relationships that didn't work out, at work. Suffering can also come from the body. If we don't know how to truly have compassion, take care of our body, to recognize that we're pushing ourselves too much, that's a suffering. So we can learn to relax, lie down, rest. Feeling tired can be a feeling of suffering. So what do we do when we feel tired? Do you know what I do? I look for a chair and I sit down. It doesn't have to be complicated. You don't have to get under the covers and lie down and say, I'll see you in 2 hours. It doesn't have to be that. I look for a chair. And one day I did that, and someone came into the room and the person said, are you sick? I said, no, I'm just resting. So the suffering in the body can be as simple as feeling tired. Maybe the muscles are tired, so sit down. Or go to the meditation hall here. We have, each hamlet has several meditation halls, so you can go there, they're always open. You can enjoy sitting meditation or total relaxation as a way of taking care of a feeling of ill-being in the body. So it doesn't have to be a terrible suffering, but just a feeling of ill-being. Maybe we feel cold. Okay, a little bit of suffering. Put on some more clothing. All right, so we find small ways of taking care of our body. Small ways to bring back a feeling of well-being. So suffering can be from our mind. If we think too much about past events that cause suffering, the source can also be from our body. And we want to look at what food we're eating. So that's the fifth mindfulness training, consumption. Are we eating just enough? Are we eating too much? That will be suffering for the stomach. Are we eating too little? Not enough energy. So we know the sources of suffering can be with the mind, particularly if we have negative thoughts, not only in the past, but if we're thinking too much with criticism and blaming. And that's almost an instant source of suffering for us and others, if we criticize and blame. So we want to have more energy. And the Buddha proposed that there are 5 sources of energy for us. The first one is confidence. We'll add to that some other words. Confidence, faith, and trust. If we have confidence and faith and trust in ourself and in our practice, we'll have more energy. because we know we can do something. I know I have confidence in my capacity to just stop and breathe. I have faith in the practice of mindful walking, because I know that if I feel anger, the best thing I can do is to just stop and take care of this emotion, embrace it, hold it tenderly. Any emotion of suffering, I want to hold tenderly, as a mother holds her child that is crying, her little baby. And maybe some of us haven't had babies to hold. If we wear the brown color with our head shaved, we don't have babies to hold. But maybe we had the opportunity of holding a little bird, or a baby chick, or a baby bunny, a puppy. And I think all the hamlets now have had experience with kittens. Every hamlet, even New Hamlet. So we know to hold a little tiny, tender animal is a way that we can also hold our suffering. So we want to do that. We hold it, embrace it. We hold our suffering. We recognize it. We give it our love, our compassion, and our attention. And then we look deeply, as I've mentioned, what are the sources of this suffering? So when we do these practices, when we walk, when we're angry, we walk until we feel better. We walk until this energy has changed into a feeling of lightness. And depending on the strength of the anger, depending on how strong it is, how strong we feel it, my experience has been that we have to walk longer if the feeling of anger is stronger. And if the feeling of anger is terribly strong and we can't understand how we could possibly be so angry, how we could possibly have said that, spoken those words to someone, we just don't understand. We say, that's not me, I'm not like that. But in truth, sometimes we are that way. It comes up. There's like an explosion, a volcano, blow our top. Have you heard that expression? She blew her top, he blew his top. Like a volcano, and then the lava flow, that means all of the words of your anger, your suffering, spilled out. So my experience has been that when the anger, the suffering is this strong, it comes from the ancestors. Blame it on them. Because we don't want to own it completely, right? I'm not that horrible person. But it came through me. Yes, of course, I said those words, yeah. And I'm sorry. We know we have the practice of apologizing. And the best time to do that, there are two times. One is right after the explosion, you say, I'm sorry, I realized I didn't speak kindly, I'm very sorry. So you say it right away if you can, but then you have to say it again. You have to say it two times. And the second time you will apologize is when, several days later at least, when you've had enough time, the word time again, we make time, right? We'll remember that we can make time. When we make time to look, why, what happened? What was the activating situation? What were the words that watered the anger in me? What was the situation or the environment
So we look to understand as deeply as possible the contributing elements for my response, my reaction, what I contributed. Of course, if it involves a relationship with another person, then that person may have simply watered these seeds in me without knowing it. See, no one, we don't know people's unconscious. We don't know their store consciousness and all the seeds that are there. But we learn later, don't we? We learn after the fact. So we say, all right, I understand more now. I understand my father more. I never really knew my father. Maybe many of us will say that. Of course, he worked. There was mother and father. We had our meals or whatever. We saw him on vacation time, whatever was the situation. But as children growing up, I don't think we really had that opportunity to understand the store consciousness of our father or the store consciousness of our mother, all the seeds that were there. Maybe we can learn from them if they're still living. We invite them to share about their life experiences, how they met father, how they met mother, why did they marry. We can ask our parents, if they're alive, to learn more about them. If our parents are no longer alive, and we have these moments of volcano erupting in us, our anger, our whatever, we can say, maybe this is how father was, you know. And then we look back and we may think, oh yes, I remember dad lost his temper now and then. Yes, I remember that. So we are the continuation of our parents. And so we see father is still there in us, his seeds of sensitivity, vulnerability. And we manifest it also in our daily life when the conditions are there. Or we can say, why am I so sad? Why am I frightened? Why does this situation bring up so much anxiety in me that I just want to leave the room? I don't want to come out. You know, we look at our behavior and then we say, why? And then we can say, is this mother in me? Is this grandmother? And we say, yes, I remember mother was sad a lot, but she never told us why. And we know our grandparents have lived through world wars, both in Asia and in Europe. And other wars continue, you know, a source of sadness. So we recognize the sources of our sadness in ourself, in the present moment, and then we look back to see the sources go even deeper into what has been transmitted to us. And then we know, once we understand a little bit, it's time to practice with our body. It's not enough to say, oh, I'm like mom. Okay, that's enough. I'm like mom. No. We say, all right, let me walk. And mom in me will walk now, and we'll both feel peaceful. So we'll combine body practices, mindful breathing, mindful walking, to transform these sources of suffering. We have other practices like touching the earth, very beautiful practices that are available in Thay's book, Intimate Conversations with the Buddha,
other wonderful books available that Thay has written to help us with communication, with ourself. Reconciliation, another very good book. Healing the Wounded Child Within, a book Thay has written. So we have confidence in our capacity to practice with the suffering of our body and mind. We know we will come back to the present moment, recognize, embrace, and then do some practices. So confidence, trust, and faith in ourself is developed the more we practice, and then, of course, the longer we practice. So that's an encouragement for all of us to continue our practice. So that was one aspect of creating more energy. There are five sources of energy: confidence, trust, and faith. Mindfulness is an energy. It's the second one. The third one is the practice of diligence. And diligence can mean simply continuing with your practice, persevering with the practice. But it also has four other aspects that are rather concrete. And these four practices of diligence are more easily understood if we see a diagram of the mind. So I'd like to ask your permission for me to draw the circle. You know, Thay has always drawn the circle with the seeds and the store consciousness, and I'll do that now so that we can look at the practice of diligence. And before we do that, let's diligently practice some more mindful breathing. And we'll have a lot of faith and trust and confidence in our capacity to practice this. So these five sources of energy are what the Buddha called the five powers. They are sources, but also when they are activated, they become powers. They have a capacity. They give us the capacity to practice, to be present, to be able to offer happiness to others. Confidence, or you can also add trust and faith. We have the energy of mindfulness. And as we practice mindful breathing, we concentrate on the air entering and leaving our body. So we're developing more concentration. Mindfulness contains concentration. It develops into more and more concentration. While walking, we concentrate on our footsteps. We feel our feet touching the earth. We concentrate on our breathing as we walk. We concentrate on the words Thay has given. I have arrived. I have arrived. I am home. I am home. I'm living in the here. I'm living in the now. So concentration helps us live in the present moment. Concentrating while walking. Concentrating while breathing. Concentrating while eating, to name just a few of our practices. I mentioned that our practice to transform a feeling of suffering, such as anger or sadness, that we will be doing some mindful breathing or mindful walking. When walking, we only walk. We won't be thinking about the situation that activated our anger or our suffering. We won't think about the person that watered the seed of suffering in us. We'll just be concentrating on the walking, and that will give us more understanding or insight. And it's a progression that happens naturally. We don't have to say, oh, one, two, three, concentration. Now I have to have insight. When will insight come? And then you wait and wait. It's not like that. It will naturally manifest, because while walking, the mind is calming down. We're only walking. We're not creating more suffering by thinking about that which started the suffering. Then we'll have more understanding. And insight is also understanding. The fifth aspect, or the fifth power or energy, is the energy of diligence. So now let's have a look at diligence. By understanding the watering of seeds in our consciousness, so we know we have eyes, we have our sense organs, eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and the mind. The deepest layer of our mind is called the Alaya Vijnan, or the store consciousness. And in the store consciousness, there are all kinds of seeds, so many seeds that have been transmitted to us, as I mentioned, seeds that we receive in daily life by the way people speak and act, but all kinds of seeds are stored there.
I'm going to introduce some seeds. I'm going to plant some seeds so that we become aware of some of the seeds that are in our store consciousness. We all have the seed of compassion. We have the seed of acceptance. That means no judging, no reacting. Maybe we notice we have a tendency to judge and react, but we have the capacity to accept, no judging, no reacting. No criticism. We have the seeds of understanding. Patience. We have the seed of vipassana, being able to look deeply. Okay. We have the capacity to look deeply. We have other seeds. We have seeds of joy and happiness. We have the seed of being able to have right view, which comes from right understanding. Or wisdom. We have the seed of mindfulness. I'm putting a lot of seeds there. In just a few minutes, you'll know why. Thank you for your patience. A seed of concentration. Okay, but we also have some seeds, maybe unbeneficial or unwholesome seeds, such as anger, hatred, jealousy, fear, despair. Sadness, anxiety, and now we have some seeds such as courage. Fearlessness. Love. Seed of goodness. The seed of hope. So, I don't know if we can recognize that we have these seeds in us. Maybe not all of them, or maybe yes, all of them. But it's nice to spend some time to see what kind of seeds do I have in my store consciousness. And the way we can tell is how we act in daily life. Do we have understanding and compassion? Do we try to offer joy and happiness to others?
Do we have courage? Do we have sadness, anger?
So these seeds, as they are right now, they're in a sleeping state. They're not manifesting in the mind. So we don't know we have them. We don't know we have these seeds because nothing has triggered them. Nothing has activated them. Nothing has watered these seeds. But we know in daily life what happens. We have our eyes. So we may see something that will go down to the depths of our store consciousness, and it can wake up anything. We may see someone helping another person, saving the life of a little snail on the road. You know, we see the snail walking, crossing the road, and we know it's so small, it's so slow, and the car will come and smash it. So we see someone picking up the snail that's trying to cross to the other side. We see someone do that, and it waters our seed of happiness, right? We see something, it waters the seed of happiness, and then the seed wakes up and it will sprout. Like the little green leaves in spring, they sprout on the branch of the tree and they become bigger leaves. So, when a seed manifests in the level of our mind, it's called a mental formation. If it's a very wonderful seed, such as happiness, we want to help it to grow like the little leaves in spring. How can my happiness seed grow? We want to keep this happiness seed there as long as possible. One way is to invite mindfulness to be there. Seed of happiness, seed of mindfulness. When mindfulness is called, summoned to manifest and embrace whatever feeling or emotion, whatever seed is there, it will do one of two things. It will help this positive seed get stronger and grow bigger at the base when mindfulness is there. So we can say, oh, I'm feeling happy. This is wonderful. If we're not mindful at that moment and we're happy and then we jump around, we may do who knows what from happiness. It's good to be happy, but it's also good to be mindful and aware. I'm feeling so happy. We may be so happy that we decide to go on a shopping spree. We take the credit card and we share our happiness, okay? Because mindfulness wasn't there. I'm not saying it happens all the time, but we want mindfulness to be there. Suppose someone says something to us, so that's with our ears, we hear something. And maybe it's going to water the seed of fear in us, okay? So we've heard the words, and now we feel scared. Someone was angry, we feel a little bit scared. So we're going to invite mindfulness. The fear has manifested. Fear has manifested. We invite mindfulness, our good friend, to come up and embrace the fear. Okay? Breathing in, I feel fear. Breathing out, I'm taking care of my fear, taking care of this suffering. So when mindfulness is there embracing negative seed, it will become smaller at the base. So these are some aspects of the practice of diligence. The first practice is to water the positive seeds, the positive seeds in ourself and others. Okay? When the positive seeds have manifest, like of happiness, we help them to stay. Like a good friend who comes to visit, we want this person to stay with us as long as possible. Help positive seed stay as long as possible. ALAP means as long as possible. So we want to help the positive seeds be manifested. Help the positive seeds to be watered. And when they are watered, we want them to stay as long as possible. Another aspect of the practice of diligence is to prevent negative seeds. Being watered. So this is the practice of selective watering. When we learn what words or what situation brings up negative suffering in someone, we do our best not to do that, not to say that. Once we know, prevent the negative seeds being watered. Once they have been watered, then we help them go back to the sleeping state. Help them return to store consciousness. Okay, so the practice of diligence can mean both continuing in our practice, persevering, having a sense of dedication. I think that's really helpful and important. I have a sense of dedication to practice. I have an aspiration to practice. I am motivated to practice. I'm devoted to my practice. I'm devoted to my Sangha. Aspiration, dedication, motivation, intention. I have an intention to practice. These qualities help us be diligent and persevere in our practice. So we also have the intention and the dedication to practice selective watering. So for ourselves and others, we won't fill our mind with negative thoughts. We won't speak negatively to others as much as possible. So we have the five aspects of five powers, five energies, a storehouse of energy. And once they are activated, they become a source of power and energy for us in our practice. I should mention something about the kind of power it gives us. It's not the power of governments. It's not the power of political leaders. It's not the power of wanting to control. It's not related to that kind of power. It's not the power that looks for money, fame, position, etc. It's not that kind of power. It's the power or the energy to continue. It's really an energy that these practices give us. So let us give ourselves a little more energy now by mindful breathing, listening to a bell,
And then we'll continue. When our mind has more energy, life is more enjoyable. Sometimes we feel, I don't have energy to get out of bed, I don't have energy to practice. But if we do make the effort to get out of bed, to walk, to breathe, we'll have more energy. So I'd like to introduce something else now. There are some aspects of energy that we have within us. We have an awakened mind. We have the capacity to be more fully awake in every sense of the word. The getting out of the bed, the wake up, get out of bed. I'm going to enjoy breathing and walking. But the other aspect of awakening, which is understanding. When the mind has awakening, we call it the mind of Bodhi. Bodhi means awakened mind. And through mindfulness practice, we develop this awakened mind. Mindfulness is this energy of being in touch with what is happening in the present moment. Bodhi. The word Buddha comes from this word, which means awakened. Buddha, the awakened one, the enlightened one. So Bodhi. You may have heard the word bodhicitta. It's the mind of love, the awakened mind that wants to bring joy and happiness. The bodhicitta is our mind of compassion, the mind that wants to remove the suffering and bring happiness to others. And as practitioners, we like to develop our bodhicitta. The one thing that will tell us that our bodhicitta is weakening and diminishing is if we notice that we're complaining a lot, we're finding fault, we're judging, we're criticizing. And that usually goes along with a decreased interest in attending the practice activities. The bodhicitta has slipped a little bit. Like the autumn leaves falling down. The bodhicitta seeds are falling now, not so vigorous. There are ways we can strengthen our bodhicitta, and that's by being with the Sangha. And the brothers and sisters who have the opportunity to be with the lay guests, spend time with them in some way. A smile is bodhicitta. Through consultations, that's strengthening bodhicitta. By listening, strengthening bodhicitta. By sharing in Dharma discussion groups, that's strengthening bodhicitta, because we're sharing our experience of practicing.
by being able to be part of a group that offers retreats, that strengthens bodhicitta, by being out there in the world, though this is also the world, but at least somewhere else, okay? Strengthens the bodhicitta. People who have a lot of bodhicitta and really have this as their lifestyle are called bodhisattvas. Means awakened beings. And I want to tell you a secret. You are all bodhisattvas. We are bodhisattvas. But we may not know it. We may not appreciate it yet. In our tradition, we know in our chanting book, there are evoking the bodhisattvas' names. There's the bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara. We evoke your name, Avalokiteshvara. We vow to practice your way of understanding, listening deeply without judging and reacting. So, if we're able to do this at least once, 1 minute, 2 minutes, we're already like the Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara. We have compassion. We have acceptance. We're not judging. We're not reacting. Avalokita. Whether these bodhisattvas actually have a historical existence, whether they truly existed in a particular time or place, Thay has said that's not so important to know. Thay gave a wonderful Dharma talk, I think it was January 15, 1998, where he talks about the four bodhisattvas and how we have the same qualities of these bodhisattvas. We are Avalokita. We are Avalokiteshvara. We see we have the seeds of compassion, acceptance, listening deeply. When we listen to our family members, to someone who needs to talk, we're Avalokita. We're manifesting this bodhisattva quality at this moment in our daily life. It doesn't have to be long, but it's that moment we are there. We're truly present. There's the other bodhisattva, Manjushri. We know you're able to look with the eye, look deeply. I have the text. You want to hear it? Okay, I brought the text. Okay, we invoke your name, Manjushri. We aspire to practice your way, which is to be still. That means to stop. We've already practiced stopping. We know we can do it again. Stop and look deeply into the heart of things and into the hearts of people. So we're going to look deeply to understand. We will look with all our attention and open-heartedness. We will look with unprejudiced eyes. We will look without judging and reacting. So Manjushri and Avalokita, they join hands. They both look and listen without judging and reacting. They inter-are. They're not separate. Avalokita and Manjushri. We will be able to understand the roots of suffering and see the impermanent and nature, selfless nature of all that is. So when we practice the second noble truth, looking into the roots of suffering, we'll be able to see the roots of suffering, and we'll be able to cut through the bonds of suffering and have a sense of freedom. So it's by looking deeply, understanding the roots of suffering that will be like Manjushri. It's the way to transform this suffering by seeing the roots. So here we are. We're also Manjushri. Understanding, patience, looking deeply, and the second noble truth of the four noble truths. Finding the roots. The third bodhisattva is Samantabhadra, working mindfully and joyfully for the sake of all beings. We vow to bring joy to one person in the morning and to help relieve the suffering of one person in the afternoon. We know that the happiness of others is our own happiness, and we vow to practice joy on the path of service. We know that every word, every look, and every action, and every smile can bring happiness to others. We know that if we practice wholeheartedly, we ourselves may become an inexhaustible source of peace and joy for our loved ones and for all species. So Samantabhadra is the bodhisattva of action. And action, what is action? We work, yeah? Can we work in this way? We have joy and happiness and service, while service? Yes, we can. We see ourselves as Samantabhadra. And on the first day of the Lunar New Year, we recognize, the monastic Sangha recognized these qualities in one another, great compassion and great action. So now we have joy, happiness, understanding, wisdom. We're Samantabhadra, right here. It's there in our store consciousness, these good seeds. We're the Bodhisattva Samantabhadra. And there is the fourth bodhisattva, Kshitigarbha. Kshitigarbha is the bodhisattva fearless and persevering through realms of suffering and darkness. This is the bodhisattva who doesn't abandon anyone, who's always there, willing to go to the places of great suffering. In our daily lives, we know there are those who go to the prisons, who share the practice of mindfulness with prisoners. There are the médecins sans frontières, the doctors who go to countries where there is a lot of disease and poverty. They offer their time and their energy to people in desperate situations. And we've learned now that that there are even the rescue boats, as Sister Chong Kong and Tai hired the Leapdao and the other boat, Leopard, just during and after the Vietnam War to rescue the boat people, the Vietnamese people who were leaving their country and seeking homes, seeking other shores. Now this is continued now because there are many people leaving the eastern country because of war there, Serbia. And they're crossing the Mediterranean, and now the Red Cross and organization, NGO from Malta, they have a big boats that are going out every day to rescue the people seeking a better life. Though we know that by the year 2015, that as of last year, more than 86 million people have been displaced because of the situation of war. And in the year 2016, almost finished, there have been more than 3,800 deaths of people in the Mediterranean trying to cross. And they don't have the means to survive. So there are bodhisattvas, Kshitigarbha, living and helping right now. And when we offer to listen to someone who's suffering, we're that person. We're Kshitigarbha. We have courage, fearlessness, hope, goodness, and love, embracing all of the suffering of people. So we're Kshitigarbha. So we know that all of these qualities we have in our stored consciousness, and it was my wish that maybe during Dharma sharing, or maybe not, we could see which qualities do we recognize we have already? Are we manifesting them in our daily life with our relationships or in our work, our lifestyle? And which bodhisattva qualities do we want to develop more in our daily life? So to be an awakened being is wonderful. We don't have to take special courses. We don't have to buy anything. It's there already in us. It's just a matter of knowing it and developing with our sangha and our practice to help beings. We know the children who come here in the summer, they start their life as little bodhisattvas. So we're all bodhisattvas in training. We're part-time bodhisattvas or a one-minute bodhisattva. It counts. A one-minute bodhisattva is still a bodhisattva. And the children learn about the two promises they can make. I vow to develop my compassion in order to protect the lives of people, animals, plants, and minerals. That's what Manjushri is doing, protecting people. And Avalokita, Manjushri. And the second promise the children make is, I vow to develop my understanding in order to live peacefully with people, animals, plants, and minerals. So they're having the two values of understanding and compassion to protect and create peace. So it's very beautiful to look at our life in terms of having a deep aspiration to offer more love and more peace in the world and more happiness. So after our formal meal today, we usually read the requests that people write. Please, will you send your energy of love and peace to whatever people or person needs our support. And we know the energy of prayer and chanting does affect others. It is reached, because this energy, Thay has said, is of a quantum nature. It's not limited by time and space. We're sending our energy to offer to the world, to these people. And we will chant, if there are requests, we chant the names of these four bodhisattvas. And we can think, all right, the bodhisattva, this great healing energy is out there.
and it's also in us. So that's, I think, what Thay really wanted us to understand in his Dharma talk of January 15, 1998, that we have these qualities and we are these bodhisattvas already. Maybe baby bodhisattvas, but still nonetheless, we are these bodhisattvas, honoring the goodness, honoring the best, the love, the understanding, the friendship, and all the beautiful qualities that are inherent in our lives and in the lives of others. So now let us again appreciate our bodhisattva nature by developing more faith and confidence and trust in this capacity of mindful breathing as the means to have more energy to help the world. Thay has written a beautiful little gatha. Many gathas that are available in the book called Present Moment, Wonderful Moment. And these gathas really help us in our practice of living with more mindfulness throughout the whole day with different actions that we do. And all of the monastics and aspirants, we learn these gathas to accompany us in developing our mindfulness. And there is one gatha called Forgetfulness is the Darkness, Mindfulness is the Light. I'm bringing awareness back to shine upon all life. So I've just lit a candle. There's another gatha that I wrote. Aware of countless Buddhas and spiritual ancestors, I calmly light this candle, brightening the face of the earth. We light one candle and the earth already is brighter. I'd like to end very shortly, but I want to share right now in the country of the Buddha's life. Buddha was born in Nepal, but he lived and taught in India. Right now in India, there is this very day, the festival of Diwali, the festival of lights. And candles are lit everywhere, in the homes, outside, at work, everywhere. There are lights. And Diwali means the light and a row of lights. So it's a time for families to be together, to share their love and understanding. It's a very joyous occasion. They visit one another's homes. For them, in the Hindu tradition, the light represents victory over darkness. That means it's goodness overcoming evil, if you want to think in terms of duality. But the light represents the goodness we have in our hearts. So Diwali is observed by the Hindus, the Jains, the Sikhs, and also a group of Buddhists in Nepal. And it's observed by people of Indian origin or Hindu faith in many countries. and in Indonesia, Myanmar, UK, I mean, wherever there are people of Indian background, this is a very, very precious 4 days for them, and it's today in India. And it's a time for families to be together, as I mentioned, for children and parents to spend time together. They visit people's homes, but they come back for the evening meal, and there's a gift exchange. So for us, it's like our Lunar New Year of death, visiting, sharing the good wishes for the new year. And in India, they do say Happy New Year, Sal Mubarak, something like that. With the gift exchange, it's also like our Christmas. So it's these the two holidays that we recognize here, and they have it all in this one special 4 day period in India. So a time for generosity and exchange and forgiveness, a wonderful start of their new year. So we cultivate the goodness in us. We cultivate the good seeds in our consciousness, thanks to the teachings of the Buddha and of Thay. And I'd like to end now by offering a reading, a short guided meditation that is found in Thay's book called Creating True Peace, Ending Violence in Ourselves, Our Family, Community, and the World. And it's called A Meditation for Remembering Your Goodness and Buddha Nature. Even in the midst of suffering, it is possible to bring your awareness to the good qualities within yourself and in others, and allow them to manifest in your consciousness. We practice mindful breathing to remind ourselves of our Buddha nature, our bodhisattva nature, we will add, and of the great compassion and understanding that we have. So this meditation is very helpful during periods of suffering, mental suffering that we may have. So we invite everyone, just sit comfortably. And we will enjoy our breathing. And we can remember to enjoy our breathing when we feel suffering. And soon after that, we'll feel better. We simply enjoy our breathing and trust in our own goodness, those seeds to manifest again for us. That is enough. Without struggling, we allow our goodness to come back to us. So we'll begin now by listening to a sound of the bell, and then I'll read the first sentence. Breathing in, I'm aware I am breathing in. Breathing out, I'm aware I am breathing out. Breathing in, I'm in touch with the energy of mindfulness in every cell of my body. Breathing out, I feel nourished by this energy in me. Mindfulness nourishing me. breathing in, I'm in touch with the energy of compassion in me. Breathing out, I feel nourished by this energy. Compassion in me, nourishing me. Breathing in, I'm in touch with the energy of understanding and wisdom in me. Breathing out, I feel nourished by this energy in me. Energy of understanding and wisdom nourishing me. Breathing in, I'm in touch with the energy of peace in every cell of my body. Breathing out, I feel nourished by this energy. Energy of peace, nourishing me.